Okay, so again, thank you so much, everybody. We might have some other people arriving, but we'll have to deal with that later. So today, the format is slightly different. We're going to have Brother Nemekin deliver the first segment on Malcolm X on the ground, communique message, basically, to black and brown and indigenous people across the world. Brother Tandema, Nemekin Tandema is an anti-imperialist activist based in London, originally from Muisca territory, which is known as Colombia today. He is the co-writer of We Are Not Latino and has organized history and political education classes for Nikantlaka people for the last 7 years. And Nikantlaka people are called quote-unquote Latinos. And the second topic today is Malcolm X's message from a black womanist perspective with Sister Sumia, who I will introduce after Brother Nemekin's presentation. Thank you.
I'll raise my presentation because I'm really bad at ad hoc speaking. Once again, thank you, Sister Nadia, for giving me a platform where I can express my views that are often unwelcome, even in the so-called progressive circles in this country. First of all, I want to say that I've watched all the previous sessions of Malcolm X that you guys have put on recently. I believe the last two lessons focus more on Malcolm's religious and personal life, while the session before that was on Malcolm's militancy. I think it was presented by Brother James Goodwin. As I am not either black or Muslim, I don't think it's my place to comment on these aspects of Malcolm's life. But I guess the sister will touch on that. So I think it's important to look back at Malcolm as the multi-dimensional character that he was. And in many ways, it's impossible to try and dissect him without looking at him as a religious person. However, what has made him relevant across so many religions, races, and cultures is the fact that his political attitude and ideas were so powerful and consistent. Brother Malcolm was prepared to sacrifice his life, his and his family's well-being for the progress of oppressed black people and oppressed people in general in the belly of the beast. A factor that has been recognized in most sessions in this forum is the fact that Malcolm's life and message has been distorted by white people and integrationists. There's the very common myth that Malcolm came back from Mecca with a different attitude towards white people. Indeed, as he states in the autobiography, he came back understanding that white people were not literal devils, but nonetheless devils in the terms of their political and economic control over black and other colonized people. So Malcolm's life, if we study it closely, cannot be rigidly separated as before and after the Nation of Islam, or before and after Mecca, and so on. Malcolm's message to us, non-white, oppressed, and colonized people, was consistent throughout his whole life. So what made Malcolm's political message distinct? Why does he continue to be so influential decades after his death? My argument for today's session is that Malcolm's political ideas were consistently anti-capitalist and anti-colonial and anti-imperialist. He was acutely aware that Europeans and European settlers had set up a world system which benefited them at the expense of everyone else. The uniqueness in the message was that even though he was part of the diaspora, he was never integrationist. That is, he was never tempted to entertain the idea that white people and their global capitalist system could ever bring about justice and freedom for non-white people. Until the end of his life, he insisted that white people could not and would not dismantle a system in which they were so privileged. He did say that he was willing to work with anyone, despite the color of their skin, if they were for the freedom of oppressed people. His definition of oppression, however, remained consistent until 1965, the year of his death. Oppression for Malcolm X was always about the white-led capitalist imperialist system that victimized non-white people and black people specifically. This message is as relevant today as it was 50 years ago. The world system that Malcolm was fighting against during his lifetime is still very much in place today. White people's role within that system is still very much one of considerable privilege. As a diaspora of colonized people here in London, we must then take Malcolm's message and apply it to our own conditions. Britain and London, far from being the so-called lapdogs of the USA, continues to be a powerful imperialist nation itself. Britain thrives in this imperialist world system and has its own special place within it, thanks to the imperialist power of the City of London. In many respects, it has been Britain's imperialist policies which has forced many of us to live here today. It would be a great dishonor to ourselves, to our families, to our own nations, and indeed to Malcolm X, if we were to attempt to integrate ourselves to this racist, capitalist, imperialist society. Furthermore, and as a way of concluding, we must be very, very careful about being misled by white liberals and white lefties in this country. Granted, there are oppressed white working class people in this country and across Europe and other parts of the world. However, despite their relative suffering within the capitalist imperialist system, white people, when taken as a whole, are the greatest beneficiaries of the world of this world system. If we analyze this phenomenon closely, we will see that poor white people often survive on the capitalist imperialist handout provided to them. In Britain, this means that the NHS, the education system, housing, etc., is funded by the imperialist economy of this country. White liberals and white lefties will then try to use and recruit us to fight their struggles for the redistribution of their imperialist economy with the so-called universal working class of this country, all the while ignoring the millions and hundreds of millions being murdered, robbed, exploited by the world capitalist imperialist system. Malcolm's message in this context is still very much as relevant today as ever before. We must fight on the side of the oppressed majority and expose the parasitism and the opportunism of white people across the globe.
Thank you so much for that presentation. Really insightful and educational. So we'll pick up on talking points in the second question and answer, just general discussion points, because I've got some questions for sure. So now I'm going to pass it over to Sister Sumia. Sumia is in the final year. She's a student in Arabic and English literature. And for her dissertation, she will be exploring the role of African spirituality in relation to themes such as healing, resistance, and survival for black female characters in literature. Sister Sumia is currently in the works of setting up a diaspora and a return society at her university. What university do you go to?
Westminster.
Oh, Westminster University. Okay, cool. In order to showcase the presence and influence of diasporic communities everywhere. She has previously worked in schools for Black History Month, interacting with students through presentations, activities, focusing on the often neglected faces of Black history, and thus Sister Sumia infuses her aspirations to work in academia with her concerns in decolonial studies. Thank you, Sister Sumia.
Thank you for having me. Our discussion today is going to be on Malcolm X's message, A Black Womanist Perspective. And I wanted us to initially start off with two questions, and one being, what is our understanding of who Malcolm X was based on, and how does that portray women around Malcolm X? And in most instances, when you ask somebody, how do you know Malcolm X, what do you know of his work, they refer often to his autobiography, if not his autobiography, then his relations to the Nation of Islam, or interviews or newspapers that wrote about him at the time. But in most instances, the autobiography would be a point of reference. And so when we look at the autobiography and we look at the presence of black women, or the lack of presence of black women, we come to the understanding that there is a missing narrative, in a sense. And so though the discussion in his autobiography, there is a discussion around black women and, you know, his ideas and his perspective on black women, though it was changing, there's also his speech in 1962 at a funeral, which is a pretty prominent speech in which was quoted in Beyoncé's Lemonade album this year as well. Starting off with, the most disrespected person in America is the black woman. The most unprotected person in America is the black woman. The most neglected person in America is the black woman. As Muslims, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad teaches us to respect our woman and protect our woman. And the only time a Muslim really gets violent is when somebody goes to molest his woman. And so, you know, reading this, we come to the understanding that there is a division within feminist and womanist circles at the time, because this is 1962, and you know, most women's rights movement did not gain momentum until the 1960s, and so there wasn't much of a discussion around feminism on public platforms, specifically around the rights of black women themselves. And so you know, when you look at it, the national organization, the National Black Feminist Organization, was not set until 1973, which is an entire decade after Malcolm X's speech. And so, you know, when we look at the context in which this speech was written in, it was at a time when the Black Freedom Movement was focusing on dismantling racism. And so when we look at the effectiveness of this speech in dismantling racism, we understand the two references Malcolm makes to the two devastating practices on black bodies, one being the systematic rape of black women, and two being the lynching of black men. And so his speech in that instance becomes extremely effective in dismantling racism. But despite that, the lack of gender consciousness was not something that was, you know, specific or exclusive to Malcolm X or the Nation of Islam or organizations at the time, because, you know, as I said earlier, the women's rights movement did not gain prominence until the 1960s, and proofing this is the denial of women in being appointed formal leaderships within organizations, despite the hard work they emitted on the groundwork. And so we go back to, you know, the missing narrative of black women around Malcolm X. And so studying his life through the perspective and through the narrative of black women, we come to understand the role they play. And so their role changes from being perhaps completely absent or from being on the margins to being central to forming many of his insights and changing perspectives. And so a lack of female presence in his autobiography perhaps presents a missing narrative that does need to be looked at and does need to be noted. And you know, when we go through the different accounts of different women around Malcolm X, we come to understand how these accounts serve to counteract the gender politics that were dominant in the myths about Malcolm X, as well as serving perhaps a different face of who Malcolm was outside of, you know, who he was as a global revolutionary, as well as the works he did in organizations. We come to understand him perhaps from a womanist perspective of, you know, where many of his influences come from, and perhaps where you know, where this narrative, where his changing perspectives come from, in a way. And so most primary and perhaps most fundamental of these women is Louisa Little, his mother, which though she does get discussed within the autobiography, her role is perhaps downplayed in her nurturing of not just how her raising up her children, but also perhaps in who she was as an individual, as a perhaps a long-standing member of the Marcus Garvey Universal Negro Movement Association, even. And so, you know, going back to the narrative of black women, we see this perspective of who she was from Ilyasa Shabazz's narrative of her father. Now, Ilyasa Shabazz being Malcolm X's third daughter, in her novel Growing Up X, she counteracts this erosion of black female presence, particularly in her father's life, as well as in shaping his work. And so Ilyasa Shabazz uses her novel to emphasize the importance of his mother and how she instills within her children perhaps a love of education, a love of black heritage, a global understanding of self-emancipation, and even a power of self-regulation. And she narrates in her book, that it was Grandmother Louise and Reverend Little who sowed the seeds of insight, discipline, educational values, and organizational skills in my father, not Elijah Muhammad. Mr. Muhammad cleared away the weeds and allowed those seeds to flourish and grow. And she even goes on to speak about his background as well, growing up. And she says, many people believe she broke down, she being Louisa Little, broke down under the weight of family responsibility because she was a fair-skinned, fragile West Indian woman. They think that before Malcolm Little went to prison and discovered Elijah Muhammad, he was an illiterate thug who could barely sign his name. Even I had this impression as an adolescent. To some degree, the autobiography itself is responsible for this myth. My father, remorseful about his criminal behavior and grateful and utterly devoted to Mr. Muhammad, downplayed his own intelligence and his family's educational and moral influence. And so Louisa Little's narrative here comes as a dramatic contrast to what is displayed of her grandmother in the autobiography. And perhaps this comes as a result of her consciousness of her gender as well as her racial identity, meaning that she becomes deeply invested in telling an unknown story, a different story about her father and the and her grandparents as well as his growing up. Other women around Malcolm X at the time, specific to his inner circle, being obviously his wife Betty Shabazz, Vicky Garvin, Queen Mother Audley Moore, and Alice Windham, who are all black activists and all women concerned with internationalism and black liberation. And I think we're going to start off with Queen Mother Audley Moore and her interactions with Malcolm. Queen Mother Audley Moore is known as the longest surviving African-American female activist in liberation of African-Americans, and she's also known as the mother of reparations. And so we come to understand her role in Malcolm's life through her narrative as well. And in 1970, she narrates that her and her youngest sister, Eloise Moore, had some influence on imparting the importance of Africa to the African-American struggle to Malcolm, in which she narrates, Eloise trained Malcolm. It wasn't Elijah Muhammad. Malcolm didn't know nothing about Africa. Eloise taught Malcolm about Africa. And I can tell you that when I wanted to talk to Malcolm about Africa, he wouldn't mention the word. He told me before he could even say the word. He told me before he could even say the word, it would have to come from Elijah Muhammad. So I told him to make the appointment for me for Elijah, and he made it. And I went to Chicago, and I talked to Elijah. I spent 3 days in his home, across the breakfast table, him and I arguing about Africa. He didn't want to hear nothing about it. We had to teach Malcolm here, and that's how he was able to get a new insight, put that to work. Now, coming back to this narrative, we understand that the focus of the Nation of Islam at the time was black nationalism, and so the Nation of Islam's teaching obviously referred to the African American as the Asiatic black man, in a way rejecting Africa as the ancestral home. And so you know, this narration and this stance in a way then becomes understandable. But going back to the influence of Malcolm, of women around Malcolm, both Vicky Garvin and Queen Mother Audley Moore, their role in influencing Malcolm's life remains completely absent from the autobiography, and perhaps even in how they facilitated Malcolm's international and third worldist outlook, in which some of their discussions related to the importance of Africa to the African-American freedom, the global effects of white supremacy and capitalism, decolonization, and even international solidarity amongst people of color. But this isn't to argue that prior to Malcolm's interactions with these women that there was no interest in these issues, but over time comes the understanding that Malcolm's global outlook became more and more sophisticated and more pronounced towards the final years of his life. And so leaving the Nation of Islam obviously means that Malcolm is now looking for alternative answers and alternative methods for black revolution and black liberation. And so black women's role in shaping Malcolm's internationalist thought was perhaps most evident in their encounter with him in his travels in Ghana, May 1964. And I think before we go on about his encounters with black women, I think we're going to discuss a bit about why Ghana in particular. Ghana at the time gained its independence at 1957 from the British under the leadership of Kwame Nkrumah, who was a militant Pan-African visionary. And at the time, Ghana sought to position itself as the point of African unity and the third world solidarity between African diaspora. And so, the revolutionary Pan-African and socialist politics within Ghana at the time became deeply familiar with African Americans who were looking for alternative spaces for Black liberation. And so many traveled to Ghana, such as W.E.B. Du Bois, Shirley Graham, and Dr. Robert Lee. And so during Malcolm's travels in Ghana, his encounters with African, he encountered African-American women ahead of their time in both political and social matters, and some of those women being Vicki Garvin, Maya Angelou, Lewis, Alice Windham, and others. And so, these women created a Malcolm X committee in which they formed an itinerary for Malcolm X's travels. And so, even in his autobiography, Malcolm X explicitly credits these women in introducing him to third world foreign diplomats in Accra, specifically Vicki Garvin in particular, who introduced him to ambassadors from the embassies of Cuba, Algeria, and China as well. And during his time in Ghana, he also encountered Shirley Graham Du Bois, who was the wife of W.E.B. Du Bois and also a friend of the President Kwame Nkrumah. And through their discussions and their interactions, they discussed the Pan-African politics of her late husband, W.E.B. Du Bois, in which she, through their interactions, she secured a meeting for him with the Ghanaian president. And so his interactions with these women and their work created a shift in Malcolm's international, Pan-African, and even gender politics. And so I think this narration of his travels in 1964 highlight his high regard and admiration for Black women. Particularly for Vicki Garvin and Alice Windham, who were Black activists dedicated to internationalism and who met Malcolm in Ghana at the time. But that wasn't their first encounter, nor their last encounter. For Malcolm met Garvin in Cairo and imparted with her an advice in which she narrates that he advised her return to Black America to teach the next generation after learning firsthand about that revolutionary experience. And the revolutionary experience that he's discussing here is Chinese Revolution, because she was on her way to China to study Chinese Revolution. And I think it becomes apparent through her narration, Malcolm's views changing on a more international base rather than a national base. And so, while studying revolution and socialism, he crossed paths with other prominent Black radicals, such as Alice Windham and Maya Angelou. And so it becomes clear that through his search for alternative methods for Black liberation, he ends up in the same circles and the same path as other Black female radicals. Unfortunately, many of these women and their works aren't discussed within the autobiography, and perhaps it's only through their narratives that we come to know who Malcolm is amongst Black women and their work. And in a way, it enforces how the autobiography ultimately fails at capturing the complexities of Malcolm's life. And another example of that is Alex Haley uses his, in his discussion about Malcolm's travels in Africa, he uses Alice Windham's letter to her friends in America at the time about Malcolm's trip. But despite the fact that he does use the letter, there is no credit given to Alice Windham. There is no mention of her at all, even though that there are pictures of several paragraphs being exactly the same. And so, it goes back to the question of, despite how undoubtedly the presence of Black women around Malcolm X is, who tells the story is pretty much who shapes who Malcolm is, and because obviously the autobiography is edited by Alex Haley, we only gain one perspective of who Malcolm is, and perhaps it's only through the study of the narratives of these women that we get to know a different face of Malcolm. And you know, as for Malcolm's relation to Black British liberation, specifically in terms of seeking out Black female radicals, his intent on meeting Claudia Jones, despite the fact that it did not happen, meant that when he did reach London several weeks after her passing, he made the effort to still take a picture with a portrait of her. And so, you know, perhaps highlighting the similarities in their work and the in what they both stood for and what they were both, in a way, fighting for as well. And there is also another narration of Malcolm's views changing, perhaps after his travels, in terms of his international views as well as his gender politics, in an interview that he conducted in Paris in November 1964, in which he states, "One thing I became aware of in my traveling through Africa and the Middle East, in every country you go to, usually the degree of progress can never be separated from the women. If you're in a country that's progressive, the women are progressive, but in every backward country you'll find the women are backward. So one of the things I became thoroughly convinced of in my recent travels is the importance of giving freedom to the women. And I am frankly proud of the contributions of our women, the contributions our women have made in the struggle for freedom, and I'm one person for who's giving them all the leeway possible because they've made a greater contribution than many of us as men." Looking at this statement, there, we understand that there are two acknowledgements that Malcolm X makes. Is one that women as the backbone of African-American freedom struggles, and two, linking the status of women to social progress. And so it can be argued that Malcolm X's views in part are a result of his encounters with Black female radicals mentioned previously. As I mentioned earlier, not only are women of color mostly absent in Malcolm's autobiography, but they also remain absent in studies that explore his legacy after his assassination as well, which is completely juxtaposed by the direct presence of women of color at the moment of his assassination. Because, for example, Yuri Kochiyama, who's a Japanese-American radical, at the time that the assassination was taking place, jumped out of her seat and rushed towards him on the stage of the ballroom, as well as his sister Ella Collins, who stepped in to head the Organization of African American Unity after his death. And so, you know, despite their visual presence at the time of his assassination, there is still a lack of presence within studies of his work as well as his legacy post-assassination. But I think no woman that we can all argue is more important in keeping Malcolm X's legacy alive and in raising his their six children is Betty Shabazz. And I think her role is pretty eminent in Ilyasa Shabazz's narrative, in which she states, "It's clear from his mother Louise Little, Mommy did a heroic job of attending not only to our physical and material needs, but to our psychological ones as well." "She worked for us and prayed for us. She fought for us and thought for us and sometimes spoke for us. She buffered us from life and pain as completely and as long as she could. And that was a long, long time ago in my case. She spoiled us, really, but she did not so out of love and the desire to compensate for all that we had lost. And compensate she did, so utterly that I scarcely realized my family was incomplete. Not only was I a teenager, and not until I was a teenager and spent time with a friend's father did I even begin to really feel my father's absence. And not until I was a young woman and heard people talking about single parent households did I realize I had in fact been raised in one. As a child, it never occurred to me that I was part of a social phenomenon. I never felt deprived or abandoned. I never felt insufficiency or emptiness or despair or any of the things experts say children in single-parent households are supposed to feel. As far as I was concerned, I had a mother and a father and a family, just like everybody. Never in my childhood did I consciously feel fatherless. I think from the narrative, it's quite clear that from Louise Little even down to his wife, Betty Shabazz, female radicals of colour played a significant role in cultivating many of Malcolm's views, whether it was pertaining to radicalism, whether it was internationalism or black liberation. But they also played a significant role in keeping his memory alive. And as much as the woman influenced Malcolm X's work, they were simultaneously inspired by him to demand unapologetically black freedom and to love black people and their genius. And so reading the narratives of these women and uncovering the collaborations with Malcolm X, we come to the realization how interwoven the histories and their works are, and how their narratives counter the masculinist representation of who Malcolm X is, and particularly the black radical tradition. And so, it's quite clear that much work needs to be done in regards to female presence around Malcolm X. But I think on one point we remain clear, and that's that the brilliance of many women around Malcolm, whether it be his mother Louise Little, his wife Betty Shabazz, Vicky Garvin, Queen Mother Audley Moore, and other radical women around Malcolm, their influence on his work and who he was as a person remains, undoubtedly clear. And so, it provides invaluable lessons in the importance of narration and who tells the story.
Yeah, thanks so much, Sis. That was really very informative, and really grateful that you spoke here today. And hopefully we're going to pick up on some things in the discussion segment. So if anyone has any questions that they want to ask either of our speakers, or just a general question where both of our speakers can comment, that would be cool. Should we start with James? Do you have anything, or do you want to?
I will come back to it.
Come back to Sis, Aisha, do you want to comment on anything, or should we?
I guess maybe for Simya, because for me sometimes it's frustrating to be in conversation with people when they talk about Malcolm, and not just Malcolm but the Nation of Islam as a whole, and their particular treatment of women, particularly from so-called feminists, because I come across this narrative or this argument quite often that Malcolm X and the Nation of Islam in general are very misogynistic, and that they don't actually respect women and black women, and they don't give them the autonomy that they deserve. And I always find it really frustrating to come across those kind of arguments, because to me it's like, you really don't understand Malcolm if you're saying this. So I guess it's like, how do we get the balance between maybe critiquing that there is an absence of certain black women voices, but without going too far as to say that someone like Malcolm X was misogynistic, because I really don't think he was. And I, as a black woman, get really offended when I hear other feminists, particularly white feminists, who say these kind of things. And that's for both of you, and you as well, Nadia.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you for that question. Actually, I have something quite similar drawn up here, and I think that it would be an amazing opportunity to kind of attempt to address somewhat the problems and limitations of like white feminism, like even in sort of conjunction with what's happening in the political climate with, say, the election in the US, and how like something like 53% of white women elected Trump and things like this. And after that, I said something on social media, and I said something like, 53% of white women hate themselves, but not as much as they hate us. Do you know what I mean? Like, I think that's really interesting. But let's talk about that. Let's go to you, Sis, first. and then we can kind of draw in other things that I wanted to unpack as well, like with you in conjunction.
I think it goes back to the question I asked in the beginning of what is our understanding of who Malcolm was based on, isn't it? So, you know, from, you know, the perspective that someone gets, you can pretty much get a grip of, you know, where they get that perspective and what they've read and, you know, where they've read it in a way. And so perhaps to, you know, counteract that and to, you know, go against the view that they have created of Malcolm, we, you know, they read alternative narratives, especially from black women themselves who knew Malcolm, who worked around Malcolm, and who worked with him as well. And I think one example would be to read Ilyasa Shabazz's narrative of her father, but not only of her father, but also her grandmother and her mother as well, and his interactions with them, and you know where many of his thoughts and his many of the things that he stood by and believed on, where they come from. And we can see that perhaps with the interactions he makes with black and female radicals later on as well.
Yeah, definitely. Can I ask you to comment on what was proposed when it comes to feminism as well? Because I think it's really quite a relevant point, and it would be good to get your sort of like perspective on there as well.
It's difficult for me to comment on black people's experience. And,
But you can draw on it from your people.
Yeah, but from a Nikantaka or so-called Latino perspective, we have similar problems with white feminism, where white feminism creates a division between our people. And often the brown man, the black man, is demonized in order to divide us, in order that we don't challenge the structure, the system that they've put in place. That's not to say that we, because of this, the system we're living in, which is patriarchal, we obviously do have problems in our communities that we have to address and that we have to sort out amongst us. But yeah, we shouldn't let white feminism or feminism in general to, you know, we have to use feminism as a way of combating patriarchy and these outdated traditions that we have in our communities, but yeah, we shouldn't let white feminism and white people in general divide us in that way. I think we should. And we should try and keep the conversation between ourselves rather than have conversation with them, because at the end of the day, I think my personal opinion is that when we have white people, white women, you know, have a free rein on what they say and when they say it, and in our spaces, it's just, to me, it's pointless. I don't think they should have that opportunity.
White feminists. I think white feminists are like very interesting to analyze. I mean, there's a really good quote that I like to bring up to kind of just show how toxic and dangerous it can be. For example, Rebecca Felton, a white Georgia feminist writing in 1897, said, "If it requires lynching to protest women's dearest possession from ravening drunken human beasts, then I say lynch 1,000 Negroes a week, if it is necessary." So that is very interesting, and I think that the history of like white suffragettes as well, not only in the UK, but in the US, the suffrage movement was extremely, white suffrage movement was extremely racist, and essentially they even perpetuated, you know, quite transparently, their toxicity towards black people. And just people of colour in general, and yeah.
Oh no, sorry.
Oh right, yeah. I found it really interesting also that basically they kind of had a problem with the idea of the civil rights protests and things like this, and how they. I think there was a quote. Do you remember the quote? I think Alka mentioned it in a presentation once, and she said that. there was a quote about how she, a white feminist, was very angry about the idea of black people getting the vote before her, something along these lines as well. So you have got history there, and transparency of, like, you know, these are the so-called mothers of white feminism, right? They created this kind of process, sort of feminism. I don't know whether feminism can see. Is it correct? Because I personally have read critiques where feminism is equated to an ideology as opposed to a movement, as opposed to a tangible movement. A lot of the Islamist critical academic perspectives would go into how white feminism is actually an ideology, and thus it collides with sort of the ideology of, say, Islam as well. But that's quite basic, you know, like, there's a lot more to be said about that. But I think that's an interesting, this whole ideological paradigm is an interesting one. I don't know if you're aware, James, too much, but I hope you could comment on this. But Dr. Frank Wildenstein, my pronunciation is so terrible, and do forgive me, and I'm losing my voice as well. But he's an Afro-pessimist writer, and I think he's written some amazing things about this idea of, like, gendering black liberation. I don't know if you've read too much about it, but he wrote,
what's his name?
Dr. Frank Wildenstein, is that how you pronounce it? Again, excuse my pronunciation, my voice is terrible as well today. He wrote some really amazing things about the idea of separatism, separating struggle, and also just gendering as well. Like, if the black man isn't even perceived as human, this is just rephrasing his work, is it fair to even kind of separate the genders, kind of thing? Isn't it a shared struggle? I'm completely rephrasing it, because unfortunately I don't have the quote in front of me, although I'm going to try and look it up because I sent it to a friend. But while I'm doing that, have you come across that work?
Not his writings on gender or anything like that, just his general sort of conception of blackness, and sort of his affirmation of Fanon's understanding of how the black man has basically no ontology, which is to say no relation to existence or the world of reality, but it very much ties into how, you know, black people are separated from their blackness and things like that. So it applies to, I suppose, gender formations in society and culture and things like that.
Excellent. So basically the one that I found, the quote that I was referring to, was Dr. Frank Wildenstein. God, this is a nightmare because my battery's done. So basically, he says, I think that people tend to say that Afro-pessimism does not deal with gender. This is a way of avoiding the core of their complaint, which is that they don't like the way Afro-pessimism deals with gender. In other words, taking our cue from the work of Sadia Hartman, we are more concerned with the structure of violence that makes gendering for black women and men impossible. Sexualized violence against black women and men is of such proportions, Afro-pessimism, such proportions, it cannot be apprehended, that is to say, understood by the conceptual framework through which violence against non-black women is theorized. So that was the quote that I was referring to. And there's other quotes, really interesting quotes as well. And I don't bring that up that I'm an authority, but I just wanted to bring it up because I thought it was really amazing, and I was hoping James could phone a friend, James. But yeah, really interesting. And also, just as another kind of talking point, if anything, did you want to comment further or?
No, not really.
Just another talking point, if we can kind of try and touch on this, was the rise of white nationalism, and obviously the election of Donald Trump, this sort of convenient boogeyman or whatever, basically who who is elected, and now you've got all kinds of like white lefties kind of trying to. It's really hilarious because just before the elections, a day before the elections, I got an invite to a protest to the US embassy saying, if Donald Trump gets elected, we'll protest. And I was just thinking, yeah, but what if Hillary Clinton gets arrested? Like, oh, sorry, arrested, I wish, elected, then what will, happen? Basically, she also made like such grotesque statements about, going on, going to war with Iran and all sorts of like really imperialist, overtly imperialist rhetoric as well. But that never really gets so much attention because I think that she's obviously. Can you comment on Hillary? So what's the difference between Hillary and Trump? Because I'm just losing my voice and I just really can't even.
I think we continue it from the whole white feminist thing. For me, I feel is that the white world doesn't focus, or I don't think it will ever focus on the actual causes of oppression for us colonized people, which is the capitalist imperialist system. And it doesn't matter whether Donald Trump's in power or Clinton, even Obama, who's half black, is part of that same white supremacist colonialist system. And it's what feminists do. White feminists focus on obviously white women's problems, which is, a lot of the time has to do with the fact that the colonialist, the capitalist imperialist system doesn't share with them equally the loot that is made from the oppression of black and brown people around the world. They don't want to focus on that. They don't want to focus on our issues, which is the actual system in place. They want to focus on the fact that the system doesn't give them what they want, which is equal footing with a white man. And it's the same thing with the whole Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton. For a white woman, it would have probably made a very big difference if there was a white woman in power. For black men, black women, brown men, and brown women, it wouldn't have made a difference at all. Because at the end of the day, we're still going to be oppressed. Whoever's in power in the leading imperialist capitalist country in the world. So yeah, I don't think we should be freaked out. I think we should be freaked out in general. Like I think we should be taking action.
We should never let our guard down.
Anymore. Yeah, I think we should be always urgently, actively working against this system. But I don't think we should be especially freaked out because Donald Trump's in power. I don't think.
Because there's a lot of hysteria about him now. I don't know if you guys saw the other day CNN or something like that talking about the idea of branding, Muslims, like, you know, the idea that Japanese internment camps are set a precedent for this kind of like internment kind of situation. But as someone like myself, I work in sort of like the legal field, and I work with Muslim prisoners who, by the way, make up one of the largest portions of British prison. Within British prisons system, there's more of us represented in prison than they are in higher education, yeah? Same in the US, you've got obviously mass incarceration of black people. And I just find it, and obviously a huge portion of Muslim prisoners as well. And I know people in solitary confinement in the US personally as well. So I find it like a really interesting thing because internment and a lot of the people that were incarcerated in the US, people I knew, were innocent people. And it's funny because you would say, what do you mean innocent people? Like, they were never convicted. They entered a plea bargain. And if anyone knows how the plea bargain works, it's a convenient way to just basically get out of prison. You do hard time. You do a year or two sometimes in solitary confinement in supermax prisons, but you can get out, there's an end in sight. So I think that, you know, when it comes to this whole hysteria about internment and things like this, it's just kind of for people who aren't fully perhaps like engaged in like exactly what's currently ongoing. So it's kind of some of these other things that, and also just the hysteria of Trump talking about doing all these things, whereas Hillary's got a track record of, you know, she made the statement about the bombardment of Libya, and she cheered that on and things like this. So
just to go on that point, on especially on Hillary and the whole voting system, and you know, if you look at like who voted, like the number of like the races and whatnot, there's less, more than 50% of white women have voted for Trump rather than Hillary. So you know, in a way, it's, you know, it sheds light on how she is no longer representative of, you know, white women, because they did not see themselves, like even her own category is not able to vote for her in the way, isn't it? And so it highlights how, you know, perhaps so far away she is from her own, you know, group of people in a way.
It is interesting also because you see with the suffrage movement, although I said, yeah, they were extremely racist, but we'll also say that it's very interesting how white women were treated within by white men, because white men were adamant in holding that threshold of power, because I believe that there were certain instruments made by white women where it would clasp their tongue, and this kind of exists in a couple of documentaries about the suffrage movement. It was produced by the BBC, and I started watching it after the movie came out. What was that movie called? It was about the suffrage movement. I don't know if you remember, but I watched it. I was very interested in watching that kind of thing because I'm just intrigued at how white women are portrayed in the media as well. It's quite interesting to me. I'm not to victimize them at all, but to just say that, just to basically understand, even with white women being in power, like Hillary, and I do believe that white women are complicit and that they are they are first-hand beneficiaries of white supremacy, and they are perpetuating, as I said, the suffrage movement was perpetuating a lot of white supremacy and racism. But I'm just saying that at the same time, the way that they were treated, and yet they were just so so resilient. So basically, they really wanted a portion. Portion of the power, yeah, and they went to great lengths to do so, and they, you know, as I said, they perpetuated the same amount of racism. So so Malcolm X's speech about how democracy is hypocrisy as well is quite interesting. So we had this discussion before, and we said that we don't really believe in like these reformist kind of, I'm not speaking for you, but myself anyways, I don't really believe in these kind of reformist notions of change, the idea that we work through the Labour Party to assist change. So then people say to me, what is it that we can do? What can we do for our people? Our priority, as I always say, is to our people in our homelands. So if Brexit is inconvenient for us, then so be it, you know? So if you can comment on that a little bit.
Yeah, I think, again, it goes, it's just about looking at the world in a global context. And I think Malcolm used to do that all the time, you know, like, okay, they call us a minority in the United States, black people, but because we look at our world just as the United States. But if we look at the world in terms of the whole world, we are the majority. And if there is crisis in Europe and the United States, let it be, I believe that. I think that it's difficult, obviously, because we live here and we're the worst off when there is a crisis. Black and brown people, black women, brown women are the worst off when there is a crisis. But if we are to be anti-imperialist and if we do want this world to change, I believe that capitalism, imperialism as a world system has to fall, has to collapse. So, yeah, if Donald Trump goes and messes up
the United States relationship with the rest of the world, and I don't think that's a bad thing for us.
That's the interesting thing, though, because if you look at Trump and Hillary and, you know, the kind of statements they were making, I guess perhaps Trump was, in a way, bad for what was happening nationally. So in the US, you know, the kind of laws that he was looking at, whereas Hillary, on the other hand, she was more of it, like, looking at it in an international way. So, you know, those of us outside of the US won't really get affected by Trump's laws, really. But whereas if Hillary was to take over, when you look at, for example, you know, Africa, Asia, and places that you know, get bombed and drones and all sorts, would have, you know, gotten a much worse deal if it was Hillary. So yeah, that was the interesting comparison between the two.
And the thing is, like, obviously, speaking as people being situated, not like I'm not situated in this country because I want to be here. I want out, and I'm trying to get out, and I want to be out, and I will. Honestly, that is literally the only thing keeping me going. Now, there's a lot of things keeping me going, but that's one of them, right? So basically, I'm just thinking, like, obviously, I want to ideally be in my homeland. My homeland is the northwest frontier of Pakistan. I'm mixed ethnically speaking, and my people are droned. And I know drone victims. By drone victims, I mean people who were injured in the drone strike, luckily, because they weren't killed, but their families were killed. So I know those people, and funnily enough, that is literally where I'm situated. So yeah, do I want to go home? Yeah, I do want to go home. And when we speak about this, you know, it's like, how dare you, you know, you should be thankful. Don't you, aren't you so thankful for these breadcrumbs that you're handed down to? No, I'm not so thankful because I didn't grow up so great, and in a sort of, like, you know, grew up council housing and estates and stuff like that. And still there, by the way. But still thinking, like, obviously, if we kind of put in the idea, if we kind of talk about, say, organizing now and how we kind of, like, work towards sort of assisting our people here, because when we say, yeah, we're for Trump and everything, like, ideally, our siblings in the United States, like, do we want them to be branded with, like, these so-called stars that are going to be saying Muslims and incarcerated or interned or whatever these kind of proposals are, and they all talk, so we can only theorize it, and there's a lot of hysteria and everything. Do we want that for them? No, we don't want that for them. But obviously, you know, will Trump radicalize them? Will he mobilize them? Will they be something that will basically motivate our people to understand where their loyalties lie as well? Because there was a lot of Muslims, you know, Arab Muslims, because I think it's a large portion of white Arab Muslims in the US who seem to be very pro-Democrat, and they're all into this kind of propaganda about Democrat and the pro-Hillary sort of group. And it's, like, really problematic, and I mean, they just seem to be too comfortable, and they want to protect their own interests in the US because they've made a name for themselves, they've got a position in the party. So it's just really interesting to observe how they have such a huge following, and they are middle-class people who are very comfortable, and they want to protect their interests, you know?
Going back to the voting demographic, though, I was reading up on it, and it was saying something along the lines of how Latinos, for example, tip themselves under white in a way when they're voting. So when you look at that and you look at the percentage of perhaps white voters, and you take that into consideration, and it begs the question of to what extent is it made up of, you know, obvious.
I don't think they are under white. I don't know if you know about the consensus. Arabs are under white.
Yes, it says that some in some instances.
Some of them. Okay, sure. Actually, I didn't want to.
They would consider themselves white. Yeah. Some Latinos, so-called Latinos, would consider themselves white because a lot of us are quite light skin.
Yeah, fair skin. Yeah.
That doesn't make us white.
Yeah, no.
Actually, I think because I'm a bit more familiar with the work that you guys do, but some of the brothers and sisters, definitely, some of the brothers and sisters aren't so familiar. But if you can comment a little bit about this whole kind of struggle of, like, Latinos actually identifying as white and the fact that you're not white.
Yeah. It basically, what's happened is that we were colonized by Spanish people. So thoroughly that our religion, our culture in general, and the way we see ourselves, our identity has been colonized, which means that we see ourselves as white. A lot of us think of ourselves as Spaniards, as our ancestors being from Spain. Obviously, without, it's like, biologically it's true, because, but it was because they raped our ancestors. So we always say, like, we wouldn't, why would we consider ourselves Spanish or European when our ancestors were raped by them? We didn't, so we become white through rape. We shouldn't accept that.
But you're talking about the indigenous ancestors, and what group are you referring to in what we call today Colombia?
That's, it's the same thing across the whole continent, from North America to South America. The indigenous people, the original people of the continent, were all raped either in the north by the northern Europeans, and in the south by the southern Europeans, Spanish and Portuguese. And it's our, for some of us who are attempting to decolonize ourselves, we believe that we shouldn't call ourselves, we shouldn't think of ourselves as a European in any way whatsoever. We should see ourselves as indigenous people, or mixed indigenous people, and we should see the European as someone who forced themselves on us in every way, biologically, culturally, politically, and it's still the struggle that we're fighting today.
Thanks, Baba. Sorry, Aisha, you were saying?
No, I guess that answers my question, because I was just going to ask why you resist the term Latino. Like, I understand it, but I guess I don't understand, what does Latino actually mean?
What it means Latin, white, European,
right? Yeah, like, where does it historically come from?
Yeah, Latin.
And why do you guys resist that particular term? But I understand it now because of what you said. But just, what does Latino, the word Latino, mean?
The word Latino comes from Latin America. And what happened was in the 1800s, the white settlers in the south, which were of Spanish and Portuguese descent, there was the Wars of Independence. So it was the white settlers against the white people who were from Spain, who were the crown, the kings and queens in Portugal and Spain, still had control of the continent. In the independence movement, where the white settlers kicked them out, so they're saying, we don't want to be controlled by Spain, by the royalty in Europe anymore, we want to control ourselves. White settlers want to control themselves in Latin America. So they swapped the name from, it was originally called Spanish America by them, and Portuguese America, and they changed those names for Latin America, because they didn't want to see themselves as Spanish and Portuguese anymore. They wanted to see themselves as something different. Obviously not indigenous. So Latin America, because they also wanted to include in that identity, they wanted to include the French, who were at the same time colonizing parts of Central America, parts of Mexico, though unsuccessfully. So then they start calling themselves Latin America in 1856, Latin Americans. And since then, that's the official identity, and that's what they've been imposing on the population. Obviously, wrongfully, because we always say that Latinos are from Southern Europe, and we have nothing to do with them.
I guess to you, my question, as an indigenous man, how similar or how crucial do you see the kind of black and brown struggle being? Like, how similar would you say that those struggles are, and how much are they dependent on each other, in your opinion? Because it's interesting listening to you about how you say you reject the Latino term because whiteness has been raped into indigenous people, much in the same way that whiteness has been raped into African American or Caribbean people who are black, and why they also reject certain labels. And then thinking about an organization or a movement like the Nation of Islam, who have now welcomed in brown people, like so-called Latino people, into the organization, and see their struggle as being very much akin to the black struggle, just like your particular perspective on that?
I think as a diaspora, as colonized people living in London, I think it's important that brown people recognize the fact that black people are more oppressed in terms of black people are targeted more than brown people. We, a lot of the time, maybe not in the United States, because a lot of so-called Latinos do get killed by police in the United States, but here I don't feel that threatened by the police. But I'm aware that I am oppressed. I shouldn't even be here in the first place. But of course, I think the root of our oppression, in terms of like our homelands being colonized by Europeans, the fact that we can't live there and we should be living there, that's our homelands. It's the same oppression. It's the same struggle, and it's the same system, the capitalist imperialist system. Because we're fighting against that same system, of course we should be uniting. And though I personally wouldn't join the Nation of Islam, if there are brown brothers and sisters who see the Nation of Islam as a group for them to fight the oppression, then I think that's a good thing.
So how do we move forward? Basically, that was another question for both of you, and we'll go to Sister Simia first. So how situated here? How do we move forward? So is it sort of education? Like us as people, we need to first educate ourselves on exactly what the struggle is, because you know, being young, being institutionalized in you know, high school, college, university, this is not education, you know, it's education of self and history. Is it legal education? So do we need to equip ourselves? Although the police can do anything they want without accountability, and I'm not arguing for a reformist position, I do, however, as someone who works in the legal field, legal defence, obviously, I do find sort of that kind of information a useful one for protection, and just kind of know what you can and what they can do. They'll do it anyway, but it's precaution, isn't it? Mm. So you have to take the relevant precautions, and self-defense as well, learning self-defense and things like that. So what way would you say we can go forward and speak about perhaps brothers and sisters in the US watching us, and there is a following in the US actually, and we're looking to invite some speakers, brothers and sisters from the US as well, and you know, what can our brothers and sisters in the US, our siblings in the US, or our siblings in Europe do to protect themselves, but at the same time fight for the liberation of their people in their homelands? What can we do? That's such an important question, but yet such a difficult one.
It is. I think it is a big question, but it comes down to starting off with, as you said, recognizing the oppressionism to it. So, you know, creating the conversation, having circles like this where you're discussing the oppression. In most instances, being outside of a circle, being outside of a discussion means that you don't recognize the oppression, you don't see it. So it's not something that you can, you know, fight against in a way. So in order to situate yourself around conversations, around circles where this conversation is happening, and as you said, you can't rely on the educational system to give you that conversation, right? So, you know, going back to putting yourself in situations such as, for example, in circles, as you said, like where black and brown people who are being oppressed are able to create alternatives, create answers perhaps. And you know, as you said, it's not even though in a way, you know, the system wasn't created for us anyway, but because you're living under the system, so having that conversation means that, you know, as for example, as you said, the police officer, right? He's able to break the law, but he's going to be, you know, more on his toes when there is a retaliation against that, isn't it? When, for example, you know, when there's a recording, or for example, when there's a repercussion, right? So, you know, perhaps maybe not, you know, trying to, you know, change the system, or as you said, reforming yourself in a way, but, you know, creating a conscious mind, a conscious atmosphere, and a conscious space in which, you know, everyone is able to be aware.
I mean, mean we don't get the numbers, but but we get quality, right? Robert, do you want to answer that question?
Yeah, I definitely agree. I think that probably the most important thing for us as a diaspora, kind of alienated from our homelands, is to educate ourselves and to understand the causes of our oppression. And in terms of like, I think it's a simultaneous fight of trying to better our conditions here, but we can't lose sight of bettering the conditions of our people back home, which in the end equals to destroying the capitalist system. Through supporting the struggle of our people back home, we are destroying the capitalist system. When Venezuela, Cuba, Bolivia are liberating themselves from that system, not completely, obviously, there's faults in it, but they are moving towards it. And by us supporting that, we are destroying the capitalist system. So I think, yeah, we have to put our energies into supporting our homeland, our people who are fighting against imperialism, and at the same time, trying to better our conditions, supporting black people when they're being targeted by the police is a thing that we must do urgently, because that's a way of them committing genocide on black people,
yeah,
and oppressing black people. So yeah, I think it's a multifaceted fight that we have. But it has to be anti-imperialist, I think. It has to be an anti-imperialist fight. It can't just be, because then if it's not anti-imperialist, then it is reformist by default.
Mm. And I think that it has to, so obviously there's different groups that exist within sort of like a Pan-Africanist movements, and for example, even other movements like the Uhuru movement that we invited, and hopefully you can invite them again, and other brothers and sisters, Afro-pessimist brothers and sisters, and others. And then for yourself, there's Indigenous, a lot of Indigenous resistors are spoken to, brothers and sisters resisting currently the Dakota pipeline. One of the brothers actually on the front lines, one of the main organizers actually, Klee Benally, who unfortunately wasn't able to do a session, but I did a video interview with him. I think I spoke to you about that, but unfortunately at that time I didn't get to liaise with questions, but I asked him questions pertaining to anti-imperialist sort of resistance got ongoing, and he's actually been there from day one, and he was one of the main organizers when it comes to the resisting the Dakota pipeline, that kind of thing. So that is the kind of resistance, isn't it, really? Protecting communities, but how effective is it going to be up against such a... But I mean, it's very effective, really, because if you think about it, we're talking about it, you know, it's very effective, and they really did... They were very... I just find those brothers and sisters so beautiful in their collective communities. Basically, you know, how they look after each other and how they are loyal and how they will just stay resilient. I think it's quite stunning, really. But yeah, I guess we can learn a thing or two there. And then you've got brothers and sisters in Black Lives Matter and other groups here that have not only, well, here, I guess they do exist here, but a very small kind of branch and things, yes, like that. But even that, they have like Asians in their movement. I don't know if we want to go into that, but it's quite interesting as well. Actually, what do we make of political blackness? You know, like, I'll get into this conversation with these Asians who are involved in Black Lives Matter, and it's just like interesting to me, like, to what extent they're hijacking like that resistance as well. I mean, like, I find the term political blackness interesting. Like, I'm brown, you know,
it's a way to bombard everyone under one term, isn't it?
Yeah, it's problematic because it certainly erases like certain unique important struggles. So if you can you comment?
I mean, that's the thing though, because you know, the political term blackness entails that you know, all black and brown people, isn't it? So, you know, it takes away from what black means and what black struggle means. And B, it's also a way to sort of, you know, take away from each struggle and how different it is. So it's sort of like to put everyone under one umbrella is a way to not, you know, study the different ways each community is marginalized and each community is oppressed. So in a way, it's, yeah, for that reason, it becomes problematic. But also because the term black, we obviously have a visual with that term as well, so
do you want to swap it? Okay, is it, sorry, is it okay if you just swap it, because otherwise actually let's wait. Do you know why? Because last time 5 minutes left. I think swap it anyways. Swap it. It's all good. Yep. All right, yeah, sorry about that. So we were talking about political blackness and how it can be problematic in hijacking black people's struggle.
Yeah, so going back to the term black and, you know, visually the kind of image that we have when we talk about, you know, black people, for example. And so, you know, it comes down to, you know, knowing that under the term black, you aren't going to be oppressed because you look black, because you don't, because you're a brown person, isn't it? So, you know, to consider yourself under, you know, black, and then to not face everything that comes with it is sort of, in a way, taken away from what the term black is and the struggle that comes with it. So in most instances, you know, you would not tick yourself, for example, you're filling out a form under black, right? But you would put yourself under the struggle, isn't it? So in a way, it's a choice of when to put your foot in and when to take your foot out.
So I don't know if it's only to do with colorism though, because I've read a few critiques. I'm with you 100%, but I'm just saying though, just as a conversation point, like this particular brother, I have respect for him, you know, he's a good brother actually, and he was supposed to come today, but you know, whatever. But you know, he's a good brother, and he looks black. He's very dark in complexion. Do you understand? He doesn't look black, he doesn't have black features, but he
has a black,
I mean, whether he has black features, I don't know what we're talking about here, but I guess what I'm trying to say is that he's mixed, mixed anyways. So apparently he's one mixed, and we won't talk about what makes it, it's kind of obvious who he would be then. But even in the Black Lives Matter, I know that there are Asians, you know, they're like, even in the, in sort of media attention when it comes to Black Lives Matter here in the UK, there's an Asian who has, again, a complexion that's, he has a dark complexion, but he's not black.
That's the thing though, the term black doesn't just rely on a complexion, isn't it? It's, you know, not just in appearance, but when we do look at appearance, it goes back to features as well, but outside of that, it also goes back to
history,
a history as well, isn't it? A sort of known struggle in a way, so, you know, a sort of culture that you've grown up in and that you're accustomed to, and, you know, though you may, for example, you know, complexion for you may not be, you know, appearance wise a target, but you have family members, you are in a household where there are others, so you do, in a way, you are facing the struggle. So, you know, to, for that being you know, an answer, I guess, to colorism in a way. But that's the thing though, when it comes to, for example, you know, brown people in black organization, I think it comes down to the role that you're playing. I think it comes down to, are you in a way putting yourself as a representative of black people, or are you fighting alongside black folk for black rights? So it comes down to the role that you are playing and the role that you have, that you see yourself as, a black person or a brown person.
Actually, you had this conversation at a panel discussion that you were on, and so I watched a bit of it, but only because someone sent me it recently, and because this person was also on the panel, so that's how I was drawn to it. Don't worry, not following your activity or anything. No, just kidding. But yeah, so basically somebody sent me it because I was having this conversation with him, and he was on the same panel as you, so I'm just very interested in how you would kind of interpret this idea of political blackness. Because yourself, we've spoken on occasion, you said you've got mixed heritage as well, mixed European and Caribbean, right?
I said it in the video and I'll say it again because I still haven't made up my mind completely when it comes to political blackness, because I understand the importance of kind of like solidarity between colonized people and I support that, but I am also very cautious of how individual struggles can get conflated and be seen as one when they're not one and the same.
Say that again, seen as one what?
One and the same when they're not. For me, like I call myself black, but not like in a political blackness sense. Like I call myself black because I genuinely see myself as black. Like my father is black. Even though my mother is white, I was raised by black people. I wasn't raised by any of my white family. I don't know my white family. So for me, like my whole kind of conceptual sense of self is completely like enveloped in my blackness and my black family and my Caribbean heritage. So for me, when I call myself black, I'm not saying it in a political sense, even though it does encompass a political sense. It's coming from a real genuine sense of self-identification that is culturally rooted. So, I mean, and I've kind of faced backlash from people who are like, why do you call yourself black? Like, you don't look black is what I get a lot of the time. But I don't know, I honestly find political blackness very confusing. If I'm honest, I find it.
I think Paul Gilroy writes about political blackness a little bit. He's a very respected writer and academic, and I really respect his work. And I too would disagree on the term of political blackness because I wouldn't identify myself as black.
I'm more leaning to the side of I disagree with it. I'm more lean to the side that I disagree with it than I do agree with it. Though I do acknowledge the importance of there being a kind of sense of solidarity between colonized people.
I think it's more than solidarity though, because I think there's an alliance.
Yeah.
Am I right? Because I think it's more than solidarity, because I don't really know what solidarity is other than the leftist interpretation, which is this whole kind of, I don't know what that is, it's just speech, right? But there is a very real brutal history in my continent, Asia. A very real brutal history where genocide also took place, where my homeland was economically pillaged, my people were also raped and murdered in the millions as well, and at the hand of the British Empire. So there is nothing that is tiny about that form of oppression. We're not more oppressed, but we're definitely saying that there is a brutal colonial history there, and there's a brutal colonial history, as the brother spoke about earlier, and there's, and I would say a far more intense brutal history, as the sister was speaking about. But I guess what I was saying, that I wouldn't say that there's even ongoing today in my homeland. As I was saying, the drone strikes is a very real thing, and also the war in Afghanistan is a very real thing. And millions were, you know, displaced, killed, thousands were killed. So it is a very real thing that's ongoing today. And I would say my homeland has seen, you know, there's been blood spilt that has been unaccounted for as well. So,
can I ask a question? So would your people in your homeland call themselves black?
No, that's what I said. That I don't agree. I don't call myself black. I didn't agree with that. But I'm just saying that I think there's definitely more than solidarity. There's like alliances. I know that there's definitely... Oh, I would never. That's not even a question. Did I give the impression?
Correct me if I'm wrong, but like political blackness emerged more for people who come from countries like Britain, right? Where it's
Definitely.
Not root, like you're up, you've been uprooted from your homeland.
Yeah, definitely.
Somewhere else, completely different.
So is it like Eurocentric?
So it emerges like very specifically for a country like Britain, where we're all kind of packed together under this umbrella of multiculturalism, but yet we face institutional racism and we face discrimination. I mean, it worked like, I guess for a country like Britain, to some extent, it's important, but then I also think, like what you were saying, it's more important to actually look back to our homeland and actually see ourselves as belonging more to the struggles that are going on back home than necessarily the struggles that we're facing here, even though that's important. Like, I'm more inclined to look back home than I am to, like, dedicate myself to this thing of political blackness, if that makes sense.
Yeah, because the whole political blackness is based
in Britain,
in Britain,
right?
So it talks about the oppression that happens here.
In Britain, so.
So, and that's important to think about the oppression that happens here. But if that's your only political goal.
And also, there's anti-blackness within brown communities as well.
Exactly.
So I would never even hijack the term. I actually brought it up for that reason, so I don't want to give the impression that I did say that my people endorse it. But I was just trying to say that, I was just trying to basically highlight that the real oppression that ongoing in black and brown communities in the homelands is not exactly the same, but I would say that there's a shared, as I said, anti-colonialist struggle when it comes to our homelands, right? But we have unique struggles, we have our own histories. We can't obviously look to your history and be like, oh, you know what, everything that your people are going through, my people are going through, and so on and so forth, because that's wrong. There's different struggles, unique struggles and histories.
And it's the same, like, if you talk about, for example, where I'm from, so-called Colombia, Mexican territory, where black people who live on the coast, the majority of people, black people in Colombia live on the coast, and they're the most oppressed people in that in our country. And we're oppressed, but they are the most abandoned, oppressed people in our country. And for me personally, and I wouldn't be able to call myself politically black simply because the experiences are too different.
Definitely.
And I think even in this country, like, political blackness is kind of falling in on itself. Like, it's no longer working. Because I've seen more recently, like, where there have been certain organizations that have mobilized themselves under this term of political blackness. Like, people who are actually black are beginning to be frustrated that non-black people are kind of hijacking and appropriating the term and claiming to work under this kind of umbrella of black solidarity. And I've been in those situations where I've been, you know, in a situation where this organization, everybody bands themselves together under the term political blackness. And in order to be able to attend certain things, you have to actually tick a box that says, I identify as black, right? But then when you go and speak to the people and you ask them, like, do you actually see yourself black? They say no. You know what I mean? So it's kind of like, you get to pick and choose when you want to be black and when it's convenient for you. Like, you can step into a particular environment and say, yeah, I'm black, and then walk out of that environment and no longer be black, and that's convenient for you. It doesn't work. Like, it doesn't work. It creates more problems than it does.
It's a certain amount of privilege that comes with that as well, isn't it? It's like, and also I think someone who's obviously confused with their identity, maybe, I don't know. But yeah, interesting. So so when it comes to obviously anti-blackness as well within like brown communities, like, actually, you know, Malcom, this is an interesting discussion. Do you reckon, because I've tried to trace this, I've tried to look into kind of, this exists and it's very real and across the board, but where is the root cause of this psychology? I was having this conversation, I think, I don't know, was it me and you, James, having this conversation? I think it was it me? I can't remember who I was having this conversation with, but we definitely had this conversation and we tried to trace, like, basically, what is the, where does it come from? Does it stem from colonialism? Because pre-colonial times, Asia actually had a monarchy that was African. So, but that's not to say that obviously that's going to erase any blackness, even pre-colonial times, because pre-colonial times there was still certain ethnic group called CD Asians, and they have African origin, East African ethnicity, basically. Anyway, you can look it up, because the information that I prepared, unfortunately, is not available at this moment. But yeah, so where does this come from? Although we can't say we can trace the psychology of anti-blackness
in contemporary understanding entirely due to colonial times, and this whole self-hate, internalized self-hate that brown people also perpetuate, and they kind of hold white people on a pedestal, and they basically fantasize about being white, like in my continent you've got the fair and lovely and all that. So yeah, just a little bit on that, and then
I think it boils down to the same thing, which is the global system. Yeah, there were relationships between African people and other peoples around the world before colonialism, but colonialism
intensified.
Colonialism has changed that relationship. So even if there were relationships with African people with other people around the world, colonialism has changed that relationship. And it boils down to the same thing, which is the white supremacist ideas, the racist ideas, which serve as a justification for capitalism and imperialism, at the end of the day, I think black people, African people, are right at the bottom of that racial hierarchy that colonialists have put in place, and that's why you see it in indigenous, in my community. We also see anti-blackness, and it's because of that, because of the capitalist imperialist system which imposes those views of race on us. So yeah, that's.
And there's a lot of, as well as anti-blackness, as I said, there's that internalized self-hatred as well, and that basically, I think in the past you've spoken about the Latino obsession of wanting to be European.
Yeah, it's contradictions, isn't it?
Appropriating European culture, triumph.
Even there's contradictions, isn't it? Because even though there's a lot about people who are anti-black, they want to be, some of them want to be culturally black. Music and the way they dress, etc. And it's the same here, and that's why I think the whole being politically black is so popular among some people, because it's the contradiction of there's anti-blackness, but I don't want to be my own race because my race is oppressed, so let me try and fit in with another people.
But then even with that loving the culture, it's like, it's kind of like this whole cultural appropriation thing where, not that, I don't know how cultural appropriation comes into the conversation when it's brown people imitating other brown ethnicities or whatever, I don't know how that conversation comes in. That's an interesting conversation, but the thing is with that is that you're just basically living off a culture that's not yours and then disrespecting the people as well, no? Like, to a degree.
So there's two things. You disrespect the people whose culture it is, and you are neglecting your own identity, your own people, and your focus. So then it's no good.
Yeah.
I don't think it's any good.
So that's why the education of the self, as Malcom X, if you want to comment a little bit, sorry.
Blackness. I mean, that's the thing that, as you said, I'm not too sure of where that hierarchy comes from, pre-colonial. I mean, I think we're all aware of how it works within the colonial system, isn't it? Putting, you know, the privilege that comes with being fairer, the privilege that comes with being mixed and whatnot, and then like ranking, those with fairer and those with mixed heritage with higher statuses and giving them the power in a way in creating the hierarchy to put the darker skinned, the more black appearance at the bottom of the hierarchy. But I don't know, before colonialism, that's an interesting one to look into. I mean, I don't know how it worked before that.
I don't know about that when it comes to, say, looking at Pashtun people in Asia, because I don't know, because I'm ethnically Pashtun as well. My mum's ethnically Pashtun. The thing is, like, we had the so-called Alexandra, the not-so-great
rape and colonize our people, you know. And there's an indigenous tribe called Kalash tribe in our area who look, they've got brown eyes, sorry, they've got blue eyes and they've got blonde. I don't think they have blue eyes, sorry, they've got like green eyes and they've got like blonde hair or whatever. And the thing is, some of my cousins look like that, but they aren't European. They are entirely brown. If anything, they're the very, very oppressed people. They're very working class. They don't even live in properties. They live in refugee camps. They live in they're internally displaced people because of like the Afghan war and things like this, and drone strikes, as I was saying. And you've got these kind of things. So I think that as being, but not to obviously say that there's not this anti-blackness when it comes to the color of your skin and all this.
I think pre-colonial though, there's also there was more of an interaction of Asia and Africa. When it comes to even whether it's trade, whether it's just traveling or whatnot, right? So when you look at, for example, where I'm from Somalia, so its strategic location on the Horn of Africa and its influence of connecting both, you know, Asia, so India and you know, China to African countries and even Northern African countries and perhaps going even to the Middle East. So the so you have when you look back at the history of my country, for example, there is more of a mixed heritage in a way. So you have more of a mixed ethnicity in that location. And I think when you think of it like that, pre-colonial, of how the world is more connected to each other outside of Europe and North America, and how North America and Europe have sort of situated themselves in order to be in control of that. Movement and be in control of, you know,
their relationship.
Yeah, to put themselves basically at the center of the stage, isn't it? And how countries like your own, how countries like my own, are persistently, you know, fighting for freedom, fighting for, you know, to have a safe, a home, a safe space. Because of the strategic location that they have, and you know, if they were to prosper and if they were to, you know, be, because for example, my country is, you know, I remember there was a documentary a couple of years ago on BBC about how it was the, like the most dangerous country in the world, right? And then when you think about, you know, how it's, you know, colonized by almost, you know, 6 to 7 different countries. And then you think about how, you know, terrorist groups, for example, that are implanted in certain areas, and then you relate that all to, you know, how a country was prior to colonization, you know, the influence it has and where it stood on world ranking, for example. And you know, you take that all into consideration and you see how things work out, really, isn't it? And how power is sort of, you know, handed out or taken by Europe and North America, I guess.
Definitely. And ongoing, like again in Somalia, another one of the countries that is heavily droned as well, which is really disgusting. And a lot of obviously people, children have been killed as well. Just as a concluding point, sorry, I've been meaning to ask, so womanism and this feminism conversation, black feminism conversation, when I read to a degree about what womanism kind of was and the theory of womanism, I was intrigued by the fact that Alice Walker made a statement to say that womanism was not a separatist.
What did she say? Something along the lines of how lavender is to purple, isn't it? How it's like a branch of, and how womanism is sort of more pertaining to or addressing issues of black women, anyway, and brown women as well.
Do you, would you say that womanism is a successful alternative to white feminism? And is womanism only for black women? It is for only for black women. I'm pretty sure that was made clear, right?
Because then you have the, what's the other one called?
Third world feminism, yeah, that was what I was looking for. Yeah. But there are,
there are sisters that I know who would identify. I think there was a Turkish sister who I spoke to at some point, and she identified as a womanist. Mm. So I don't know, what would you say about that? But it's very specific to black women. I was pretty certain of it.
Yeah, that is the thing, because when Alice Walker was coining the term womanism, she based it on a lack of the lack of a platform to discuss and perhaps address the unique issues of black women, isn't it, and how that pertains to the black race overall and black men as well. So yeah, I definitely say you know, she started it off and based it on black women, but how that relates to feminism, I think we all know how you know, feminism originated for white women, isn't it? How, you know, white middle class women created feminism as a way, as you said, to get a split in the power. And so in a way it was never really serving anything outside of that for the longest time. I think obviously it changed towards the late 90s. But I think because of where it started for me personally anyway, and you know, the things that it's rooted in, you know, it was never created to serve the issues of black women, for example. So, you know, even up until now, though, not much has changed, and even though there is black feminism, for example, you know, I mean, I don't know the difference between black feminism and womanism. They pretty much, you know, touch on the same issues, I guess. But yeah, how feminism for me doesn't fully encompass the issues that black women face.
I think it is very radical to actually frame it entirely different and detach itself from feminist label itself, actually. So the whole womanist movement.
Actually, going back, because I remember at the time when she was coining the term womanism, she was saying how, because obviously there was black feminism as well, and how in a way she wanted something outside of feminism, how simply putting black in front of feminism wasn't enough for her, mm-hmm. reason why she coined the term womanism.
Yeah, and that's exactly what I was thinking. Oh, I remembered the point that I wanted to make earlier. So I was talking about how white women, yes, they were vitriolic in their racism when it came, like certain women in the white suffrage, white feminists, well-known feminists that I talked about, Rebecca Felton. but then again, the thing with white women is that they're the ones. So the point that I was trying to make is that I propose that white women actually need to be saved, because if you really look at their history, they were oppressed by their own men, you know, mm-hmm. and their own men were extremely misogynistic and patriarchal towards them, mm-hmm. You know, caged them, lashed them, whatever, force fed them, and so on and so forth. And patriarchy was upheld by the white man, and white supremacy, the first victim of white supremacy were white people, like Irish people and so on, but then again, white women, you know, mm-hmm. like they were burnt at the stake, called witches. So white women really do need to be saved. So I understand why you have feminism, but the rest of us...
Well, that's the thing, though. I think, in a way... Because that's the thing. Feminism was created by who, though? It was created by, you know, a middle-class woman who wanted more outside of being what we term a stay-at-home mum, in a way. Is that she wanted, you know, be able to have a space in the workforce, reason why, she, you know, that's where feminism originated from, in a way. And, you know, I think, okay, fair enough, you know, as you said, white women perhaps being saved from white men. But I think at this point, at the age that we are in as well, I think it moves beyond that, because, you know, it's gone so far off. Because you have colonization. That's a prime example of how it's moved on from white women.
Yeah,
because
because
when you look at slavery, for example, you look at how white women obviously had control over the slaves. Mm. So they had a form of power, right, that perhaps prior to colonization that they weren't able to have. And I think in a way it begs the question of saved by who, though, because everyone else, you know, has, you know, is trying to save themselves at it. Yeah.
No. I was being ironic because
yeah, I know what you mean.
You
in a way,
got
yeah.
that whole kind of discourse of the white woman, you know, wanting to save the Afghan women from the Taliban. Like, seriously, give me a break. We're trying to save ourselves from every bomb. Like, you know, I speak to my relatives and they just want to be like, you know, they want homes, like their homes were bombarded, they're displaced. Mm-hmm. So I really don't think the white women can save anyone. They just need to like chill, like, do you know what I mean? Like, so that was basically my main point, really. Mm-hmm. I was trying to be sarcastic. I don't think, you know, I think the white woman is one of the most privileged parties and benefited and a sort of direct beneficiary of white supremacy since colonialism. And even like if you look at the relationship of the master's wife and things like that, you've got like depictions in literature and in media like about the white woman and how she basically partakes in oppression of black women who were enslaved as well, which is, I think Bell Hooks speaks about this.
And emasculating black men as well.
Exactly. Yeah. Actually, can you comment a little bit on the what Bell Hooks says? Because Black Bell Hooks is a very respectable...
Because that's the thing that she... I can't remember which book it was.
She's very radical.
Yeah.
She is very radical.
She's one of her books is... where it talks about, I think it was that one actually, where it talks about the origins of feminism and how it was originally for middle class white women. But she also talks about how the necessity of spaces outside of that, because I'm currently reading her work on feminism, so I haven't gone outside of that yet. But yeah, relating to how, you know, the origins of feminism and how it's never been for black women or brown women or women of colour in general, and how that is perhaps still an issue today, in a way. So yeah, but outside of that, I haven't really read, because she does write a lot on hypermasculinity and, you know, I think she even wrote on incarceration, but I'm not.
I don't think I would be really interested in that actually, so let me know.
It may be on black bodies, if not black male bodies.
Yeah, she comments a little bit on that, yes. Yeah. Although I can't remember the exact quote, yes, she comments. But I thought it was just a tiny portion, but if you find anything more, definitely let me know. But actually, James, if I can bring you in when it comes to. Depictions through literature and black life and black bodies as well, if you wanted to make a comment.
I suppose I was just thinking on what you were saying about political blackness, which is interesting because I agree with everything you said about it, which is to say that political blackness, I suppose the way I understand it, is exactly the way that Sumi said, which is it's historical, which is to say that it's not actually identifying with black people, but just but more sort of identifying with what the term blackness or political blackness denotes, which is more of a treatment, a historical treatment of black people. And so that's probably so in one sense, which isn't really thought out, which I haven't really thought about much, but it's like political blackness is kind of anti-black because it disregards. Sort of the complex individual experimental bodily formations of blackness, which is to say black people are you know historically mixed, whether you know whether it's been raped or like, you know whether it's been a pre-colonial tribal things like that, and so you know, it's interesting. So in one sense, it made me think about homelands, you know, which is to say. I was born in England. I was born in Essex, but my mum was Kenyan. She was born in Nairobi to an English father and a Kenyan grandmother. But one of my grandmother's grandparents was an Arab. He was a medicine man, and so my home isn't situated. It's like I can go back to Africa, but I can also go back to Arab. And go to somewhere in Arabia, and go somewhere down further. It's like, you know, I identify with my homeland in the same way I identify with political blackness. I just identify with, with a certain struggle and certain conditions which I can recognise, I can directly recognise and can directly like relate to, etc. But I can't identify with my grandmother's life, for instance. Like she grew up in the, during the Mau Mau rebellion. She lived in a she lived in a camp for about 2 or 3 years and things like that, and her family were dispersed all around Africa. And then she talks about one time about working as a housemaid in some white South African suit and things like that, and not being a very good one. In that sense, I don't sort of agree with that term political class. But in another sense, I would always be on the side of someone who's identifying with the struggle because I can relate to that struggle as well. So if someone wants to identify with political blackness, then I would be alongside them, which is to say I'm always on the side of the oppressed, like you know, things like that. In a broader way, I was thinking about that because I was thinking about whether Zumia could, and then again if you want, could expand, if possible, on like the relationship between spirituality, ancestry, and homeland. She was talking about how she was saying that you know you should tell the next generation about Africa, about you know, where you came from, and things like that. So I was wondering if there was a broader connection, but it could also be sort of relevant to them in the sense of you know having that kind of closed conversation with your own people in terms of how to deal with capitalist imperialism and things like that, which is to say like white people do it, they just don't know really. But like we have a more nuanced understanding of struggle, so that's a side question or a side thought.
Yeah, definitely. Let's go to Sister Simeon and then we'll go to the brother.
I'm originally Somali, but I was born in Holland. So the first time I went Africa or Somalia was last year. So outside of that, what I considered home or what I considered as my lineage or even my history in a way was what, you know, what my parents gave to me, what the community was able to give to me. So definitely in terms of passing down, because outside of that, you know, there would have been no necessity of me to go back home if I never felt a connectedness to home, isn't it? So that being the importance, but in a way, the relationship between spirituality and ancestry, in a way, I think, because I'm writing my dissertation currently on that and how spirituality in a way is not just a form of religion or a healing, but more so a recognition of where you come from as well, of what your ancestry is, and also more of a recognition of what you're not as well because of where you're located. It's easy for me because I was born in Holland, I grew up in Holland, I have a Dutch passport, so it's easy for me to consider myself Dutch, right? But for me to look at the struggles that I go through, the struggles my family members go through, you know, what my lineage is and what my language, for example, is, what language I speak at home. That being outside of my nationality, that being my ethnicity, being an ethnically Somali person, and that being passed on because of the connectiveness to the spirituality as well as the conversations around home and history in my own household and community. But yeah, that's pretty much.
Can I pass it on to
you? Yeah.
I wanted to ask one thing actually, but I'll ask afterwards. So Nemekin, if you want to respond to James.
Identity for colonized people is obviously very important, and our cultural identity or how we identify ourselves is very important. I don't think we should be like cultural nationalists or like, yeah, we're indigenous, but more like we're indigenous, and like the sister was saying, there's suffering. Material, very real material, cultural, political, economic suffering of our country And we identify with our people because of that suffering, not just because we're Indigenous and, you know, we dress as Indigenous people, which okay, that's good, but it's not enough. We need to be, I think we have to identify with our people because of the struggles our people are going through, because of our history, more than anything else, and do something about it. Identify with our people because we want to be part of our people, because we want our people to progress and liberate themselves from the system, rather than just a kind of blind nationalist sense of wanting to be from somewhere.
But I think that the nationalism, to a degree, can be a form of resistance, especially in the face of white supremacy,
yeah.
Where, I mean, you speak about culture, but there's an actual parasitic nature to how culture is appropriated by white people.
But the reason why I say, like, in my community, I don't know about you guys, but in my community, Indigenous nationalism is usually very cultural, focused on cultural things, which is...
It's quite superficial, but not about tangible things.
Yeah, it's not about
attaining power.
It's not about attaining power. It's not about ending the material suffering of our people. It's more about, let's look at the practices of our people, how we used to dance, how we used to pray, how we used to, which is important. But if we focus on that, that's what we call cultural nationalism. If we focus on that, we're not really going to progress in terms of.
So I think also that there needs to be a holistic resistance. So basically, every aspect of your life, try and resist in every aspect.
And as I was talking with the brother outside, for me, the material aspect of it is very important, because our people aren't fed with culture.
Mm.
We have to think about
the
material aspect is central to it, because we can't feed ourselves with, and we can't clothe ourselves with culture.
And also, didn't Fanon make that comment about land being the tangible form of power? What was it, James? Sorry, I think you spoke about it.
It's left me.
Yeah, I can't remember it either. Do you remember it?
No.
But he makes an emphasis on tangible.
Mm-hmm.
So in his writing, he always speaks about land being, obviously, control of your land is the first step. You know,
that's, for example, the situation in Palestine and Israel, that's a primary example, isn't it?
Exactly.
Of land and who has power and who's able to sort of own an entire land and claim it as their own, regardless of history and lineage.
Mm. Yeah, definitely.
It's like the brother, the Uhuru movement brother, who says it's all very well and good that we become cultural nationalists, but when the imperialists are bombing our countries, we can't defend ourselves with culture.
No.
We have to defend ourselves with power.
Definitely. Excellent. I think that pretty much...
If I just come in, it's like... I suppose one of the drawbacks of political blackness is that it kind of suggests that, you know, there's some way that, you know, black people, or brown people, whoever, have always been struggling, so that they have this claim to, you know, this kind of universal struggle,
mm-hmm.
and things like that. But like this kind of cultural affirmation, in a sense, kind of offshoots that,
mm-hmm.
in a sense, the same that, you know, before pre-colonial times, we were flourishing like civilizations. We were very more. Progressive, compassionate, and you know, and things like that. Then Europe, and before Europe, and things like that. Dr. John Hendrick Clarke says something about Africa being the formation of every major religion in the world, from these base, practices of natural worship. Which my grandmother did. Right? She wasn't religious, but she was very tribal. But it's just that sense of
No, that was a really valid point, actually. But then because this is a very real problem, and again, I'm speaking I'm only speaking about my people only because I can only speak for my people. I can't speak for your people. I can't speak for your people. That's the only reason I speak about my people, right? So basically, when it comes to my people, like, this tribalism thing can be very dangerous as well, because after the colonizers go, then there's infighting. So there's obviously tribal wars. There's a civil, what the Europeans termed it or frame it as, a civil war between tribes. But really, the Europeans had proxies. You know what I mean? So this is the thing, though. But the thing is, how can we form a united front with our people, and also those of our people that obviously sell us out? They become tools for imperialists to use and abuse. The imperialists will throw them something like that whole carrot and stick thing, isn't it? That sort of like, you know, we're feeding you and we're giving you some kind of luxuries over your other people, and you're progressing in the world, and there's no other way for you to join the ranks of the imperialists, like this whole democrat obsession and things like this that I'm seeing for certain Muslims, Arab Muslims and stuff like that in the US. I guess I didn't also ask you the question, and this was such an important question, and hope we can end on this, because Malcolm X was a man of action, not only words, and he emphasized action, you know, he emphasized real tangible resistance in self-defense, very real self-defense, arming yourself. If you're in the US and you can arm yourself, do it. Black people need to arm themselves now more than ever. You know, white nationalism is on the rise. Other brown people who are obviously, you know, also in the US, they should also arm themselves and protect themselves, like certain Muslims and stuff like that. But so I guess what I'm trying to say is that, so what is the tangible ways of moving forward, how to move forward? And as I was talking to the sister earlier, what can we do other than education?
What can we do other than education? First, on the point of tribalism, Bolivia is a very good example of how we can become nations that respect each other in terms of our differences within our nations. They changed, Evo Morales, the socialist president, changed the name from Bolivia to the plurinational state of Bolivia, which means that they recognize every different culture and tribe, whatever you want to call it, within the country. But they're one people, one nation.
Quite beautiful.
So I think we can learn from actual living examples, people who are actually practicing. Obviously, again, it's not perfect, but it's where the different cultures are respected, where the different languages are being taught in the schools and stuff. It's a good step forward. In terms of action, I think that, again, we should focus on our energies on organizing ourselves against imperialism, and the most important thing I think we can do to defeat imperialism, which is for me the root cause of our problems as colonized people, is through supporting our people back home who are struggling against countries like Britain.
That's also tangible support as well as...
Tangible support, any type of support you can. Obviously, for many of us, we're poor, so we can't give financial support to the struggles, but we can do... We have things that we can do for them in terms of propaganda, in terms of spreading the word, maybe creating a branch of whatever movement, whatever strong radical anti-imperialist movement we have back in our homeland, create a chapter here for that movement, spread the word and make it stronger. I think that's the most important thing. We have to organize ourselves against imperialism and not focus so much on trying to integrate or trying to make life tolerable here while the lives of our people are continuing to be intolerable elsewhere.
Definitely. And this is the thing, you were speaking about building a chapter here. I think for me, as I said, that how would you engage with the people that betray the cause, though, and that are not willing to
to obviously be loyal to their own people, because this is my thing as well. I think honestly, I think education is a very important tool. This self-education sort of kind of momentum is a good tool to build alliance with brothers and sisters like yourself, and then basically how we reach out to our own communities. You know, you're doing, but I want to invite you, so we learn from each other as well. And I've been learning from obviously thinkers like Malcolm X. Obviously I'm not black, but I can learn, you know, you can learn.
And Malcolm X was
very, he's a teacher.
Yeah, and he said we have to be very patient with our people. I think we're very quick to point our finger at people when they do integrate, or when they do things that to us that we wouldn't do. But we have to be very patient, because they haven't arrived at the same conclusions as us. They haven't studied
so quickly. Yeah, because there was once a time where we didn't know what we know.
Exactly.
That's what he said.
We have to be tolerant.
But hold up, but I would not be tolerable of somebody who would say one of my own community members joined the army to fight in Afghanistan.
Yeah,
that is just not going to happen, because that's the level of tolerance.
But it also depends on how you approach it. If you approach it in an antagonistic way, are they going to listen to you? Whatever choice they make, they're doing it out of ignorance. If they're joining the army, they're doing
it. And also desperation, because many of them are dirt poor and they want to have an avenue to provide. But that's not to excuse
lashing out at them and being intolerant.
Yeah.
And not listening to them.
But what if they are proxies? So, for example, you had, as the brother, if you recall, he spoke about a Quintel Pro program that disintegrated.
Oh yeah, that's different. When
so people
when
who people, betray you.
Yeah, no. When our people are directly, very consciously working against us, then, as Malcolm X would say, and as he would have done, you have to go against them as hard as possible.
Because they obviously counter-revolutionaries, aren't they? So.
But I think, very importantly, the majority of our people aren't that. The majority of our people are
unfortunately
haven't arrived at the same place that we have. So we have to be tolerant of them. And
majority of them are not to one extreme where they want to join the US Army, for instance. Majority of them are people who may vote, but they aren't fully aware of how they should perhaps approach their struggle or something.
Exactly.
Sorry, sister, do you have much to say about that?
Not necessarily. I mean, yeah, you guys pretty much covered it, but it goes back to understanding, as you said, the reasons why in some situations somebody would be put in a position to be against their own movement, for example, as in the example that you gave back home, for example, isn't it? And how in a way to create a better situation for your family and perhaps a more safe situation. For example, the Iraqi war, and how a lot of Iraqi interpreters were promised like a passport in order to travel to the US, and how that didn't work out, because as soon as the US Army left, they were left behind as well. And it's in a way to understand the situation that put them there, and though they are left behind with their own people. So it's really on how their people decide to act and how to behave with that, I guess.
Yeah, so I guess it's really about, am I wrong in thinking that it's about loyalty, political loyalty, and the understanding that our loyalty lies with our people and in their homelands? And I also, whilst we're situated here, it's good to build with and ally with other brothers and sisters, trustworthy, loyal brothers and sisters who are basically, if you're going in, I think the brother Trayvon said, if you're going in the same direction as, it's an organic alliance, isn't it?
You'll meet somewhere on the way, isn't it? Yeah.
Exactly, so it's an organic alliance. But on that nice, positive note, often we don't leave on a positive note here. Because we're just always being critical, as I'm told, but
you know, we have to, isn't it? We have to approach it in a realistic way. Mm-hmm. So anyways, if there's no other comments from brothers and sisters, we shall end this. No? Okay, again, thank you very much to everybody who have attended. We will be basically pausing the sessions until I actually try to, until I'm able to market them, basically, so we can get some people down here. So we'll pause the sessions for a while. We'll be back in late December, or perhaps early December, as soon as I am able to access social media so I can market. And also we will email out and text out what our next chosen text will be. And if you have any suggestions, please get in touch. Thank you very much.
Thank you.